Hello Turtles, welcome to the second episode of Outside Game Dev. I am trying a new format where I take you guys outside, we're gonna go for a hike, and talk about some game development tips and techniques. Probably saw the title of this video. What is wrong with the Unity engine? Nothing. Nothing that's not wrong with other game engines anyway. I'll get into my thoughts on the cost per install a little later, but that's not the meat and potatoes of this video. Instead, we're going to be talking a little bit more about the misdocumentation and some of the tech behind Unity and how you use it. I found a nice little rock to sit on, so let's take a seat and talk about the misdocumentation of the Unity engine. Where a lot of the misdocumentation comes from is the fact that Unity's been in development for a really long time, and a lot of people have made tutorials, and the API has changed, or various bits of the engine have changed and grown over the time. This is hard, especially for a newbie. And even as an experienced developer, sometimes it can be tricky to pick out the different rendering pipelines, right? There's multiple rendering pipelines, different workflows for each of them. So you kind of have to pay attention to which one you've chosen and how that affects your project. But overall, the official documentation is actually quite nice. You can usually find what you're looking for. It's sometimes a little unclear, but most documentation has those little issues. And the official documentation, yeah, sometimes you can do your search and wind up on a different version, but usually you have a little drop down that tells you which Unity version you're using to get the updated information. Every now and then there's an API that's deprecated that doesn't give you the right page, but that's what you gotta do. You gotta figure out what's deprecated and how to fix it, and the official documentation usually does pretty good. I wouldn't necessarily say this is anything wrong with Unity, it's just most engines that live as long as Unity have, with as many different version updates and API breakages, will have issues with some of the history and documentation, especially where public are making unofficial articles, video, and other content trying to help others. It changes over time. That's how an ecosystem works. Let's keep on moving and get up to our next spot. Also, some of the technology in Unity is quite cumbersome to use, or difficult, complex. Thinking specifically of the canvas and UI tools. Like, it's very powerful stuff, but it's very complicated kind of to wrap your head around. What I mean there is there's like various settings on how you can scale your game down or the UI to fit various aspect ratios. There's not one right way to do it. There's like several different ways you could tackle, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. In fairness, part of the reason it's that way is because it allows people to do things in however way they want. If Unity wanted to make the system simpler, they could just add some limitations and kind of tell you this is how the scaling is going to work, because there's no right way to do it. There's multiple different ways, each with their own benefits. Maybe you want to scale the canvas, maybe you want to scale and position the elements, maybe you want to do it by width, maybe you want to do it by height, how you anchor stuff. All of this stuff is very powerful. And that's good. It allows you to do all kinds of good things. But it does make the system as a whole more complicated to deal with. Spiderweb. I'm gonna take a break over here as we get up to this rock. Another problem I've had with Unity while working on Accelerate was the input system. With the old input system, you were able to define an action and give it a couple different controls, and it would automatically do digital analog conversion. It would automatically handle analog as buttons. It would do all kinds of good stuff for you, but it lacked a pretty distinct feature when it came time to switch your inputs, because it wouldn't do separate controls. Like, you couldn't detect that you're on a gamepad or you're on a keyboard, because both the actions are the same. You basically had to duplicate all of your controls. You had to duplicate all your controls for each system too. Enter the new input system, which is all fancy, right? Wrong. The new input system does solve the problem that I was having in Accelerate, where it will detect whether you're on gamepad or keyboard or whatever you're using for input. Good job. It'll detect that very well. But it was such a pain in the butt to try setting up your actions and then the buttons for those actions. I've done it on a couple different games, mostly for game jams, and I have to relearn the whole system. That said, it does support almost everything I could think of supporting. Maybe not right out of the box, but you can add a digital analog converter. Why Unity doesn't have a digital analog converter in the new system is beyond me. That was actually really upsetting to me. The new system supports it, you just need to make it yourself. And I don't know how they made a whole new input system and then dropped what is pretty much a core feature of it. It comes back to the same point that I was making with the UI system. They're trying to accommodate so many different things that in the feature set that they're creating, it just winds up being complicated, right? Because there are so many different use cases. Not everyone's going to use it the same way. So I want to be clear that it's not necessarily Unity's fault. Like, this is stuff that happens in every game engine. Complexity is hard to manage. What happens when you run across a bug in the editor or in the engine? Your game code isn't the cause. It's something with the engine that's not doing things the way the documentation says, right? You have to report it, right? So that Unity will know about it. And then you have to hope that they're going to prioritize your issue. It could be that they just don't care about that particular issue. It's not important to them. Maybe not enough people have this issue, or you're running up against something that's very difficult for them to actually fix in their own code. Like, they've made certain optimizations or trade-offs that don't allow your particular use case. And you could get kind of a little bit of out of luck in that situation. Not much you can do. This applies to pretty much all dependencies, really. Any dependency you use, you'll probably wind up running into this at some point where you're dependent on them. That's the dependency part. Even in open source software, yes, technically you have access to the source and the capabilities probably to change it. That doesn't mean they're going to accept your change. It also doesn't mean that it's easy to get in there and change. The trail is about to get way harder. So I'm going to pause over here for a moment and just chill in the forest. Dependencies add a little bit of friction, and know that going in. With Unity, you can't fix it. You have to wait until the team fixes it. Of course, the flip side to that is the fact that you're basically crowdsourcing the bugs. And for the most part, if a lot of people are having the bug that you're facing, it is likely to get fixed and you don't have to spend the energy, right? Most of the common bugs are going to be fixed in something like Unity, where lots of people are using it. So I might be making this issue sound a little bit bigger than it is, but it does happen. Building a custom engine, you get to choose what you prioritize. If you don't use a dependency and instead you write it yourself, you get to choose what bugs you actually work on. I'm not going to say you're going to solve them all, but you get to say, yes, I'm spending time on that because it's worth me fixing. Or you get to choose, yes, I'll do a workaround. I know what goes into this issue and I don't want to deal with it right now. That's your choice. Like I said, with a dependency, the bugs are usually crowdsourced and you don't have to fix them. As long as the developer of the dependency is prioritizing your issue, you'll be good. That was a heck of a climb, but I'm at a little bit of a view. You don't own the engine, you license it. This video is already scheduled on my things to talk about in Outside Game Dev. It just bumped itself up the schedule a little bit because of the Unity dilemmas. Anyway, when you use a dependency, you don't actually own it. It's a dependency, it's not you having ownership over this. And that has some level of risk. Risk that the license could change, risk that the owner decides to not prioritize your issues or to go a different direction or to stop working it altogether. There's so many different problems that could arise. Is it gonna rain on me? It got windy. It's always a risk with dependencies, whether it's Unity, whether it's Unreal, even if it's an open source dependency like Godot. At least an open source dependency, you can mitigate some of this risk because the last version that was open source before the license changed or before directions changed, you still have access to. Dependencies don't only mean your tools. It doesn't only mean your frameworks. It does not only mean the things you're working with like Unity or Unreal or Godot. It can be, you're dependent to the operating systems and the platforms and everything that you use. I depend on Windows to stick around. That's where most of the gamers on desktop are. we all depend on things. I'm not saying dependencies are bad. It's just, I'm dependent on Windows and its ecosystem not to just disappear, not to make wild decisions that will kill the gaming. If it does, I'm at risk. You have to be aware of those risks. A lot of indies are using Steam. If Steam decided to pull the plug tomorrow, very unlikely scenario, I agree. But you're dependent on Steam if you're using Steam and it just disappears tomorrow, you're at risk. You're at risk when you're using a dependency, just like you're at risk of Unity changing the license terms on you. That goes to my thoughts on this whole issue Unity has brought forth. If you've been living under a rock this last week, I usually try to, Unity is changing its licensing for January 1st, 2024, and they're trying to say that anybody that's used Unity, all their games are going to start being charged like 20 cents per install. There's some more details, and I'm sure you can go find a lot better sources. There's some caps, they're getting rid of plus mode, blah, blah, blah. It's not really what we're here talking about. My thoughts, having made a game in Unity, as of right now, I'm not concerned. If it gets to be January 2024 and absolutely nothing has changed, I might upgrade that to slightly concerned. Even if my game was to make a million sales and $1 million, I would still upgrade this to slightly concerned. I believe that case would be brought in front of a judge in some way. And they're not going to see that as fair. They're going to see that as one-sided and not even ballpark near the old agreement. You can't just change your agreements like that. I really think that this is just Unity making a statement to go way further beyond what they actually plan to do, and then they're going to step it back and say, yup, this is actually what we'll do, and it's going to be a little bit more friendly than what they've offered right now for their January 1st, 2024 changes, but it's also going to be a little less friendly than what they have as of today. Is this a reason to be upset at Unity? Absolutely. I don't think they're handling it right, and it definitely breaks trust, but I also don't think it's going to be as bad as everyone's making it to be, and I have a game in Unity. I've made 3 of them. If you want to check how my first game release in Unity did, I have this video here which shares the income in the first 6 months. This was the second episode of Outside Game Dev, a series where I take you outside while talking game development tips and techniques. If you have any other topics or thoughts you'd like me to cover, please leave a comment below and I might get to it in a future episode. Thanks for watching this episode of Outside Game Dev, where we took a hike and discussed what is wrong with the Unity game engine. It's not really that anything is wrong, it's just they took a lot of trade-offs that add some complexity in certain cases. Anyway, if you enjoyed the video, give it a thumbs up, share it with other developers who might be interested, and as always, Turtles, until later, have a good one.